I'm Laura Grant, Program Assistant at the Jewish Museum of Maryland, and it's my pleasure to welcome you to our virtual presentation today, Exploring the Science in Science Fiction, with Dr. A. Bowden Van Riper and Dr. Charles Adler. Today, we are pleased to continue our series of programs inspired by our exhibit, Jews in Space, Members of the Tribe in Orbit. If you would like to revisit previous programs in this series, you can find the link to recordings on our website via the link that's being shared in chat. I know many of you in the audience tonight have joined us throughout this series, and I want to extend a thank you for your continued support. Additionally, we are pleased to announce our limited reopening of Jews in Space for museum members. From April 22nd until June 10th, primarily on Thursdays, we are offering all JMM members a chance to reserve advance tickets for designated time slots to visit the museum with up to six of their guests. You can find out more information about reserving your tickets via the link in chat. And if you're not yet a museum member and would like to join to support our work and for a chance to see this exhibit before it closes, you can find out how to become a member today via the other link in chat. As tonight's program is one of the last events within this series, it seemed only fitting to wrap up by exploring some of the works of science fiction featured in earlier programs, but from a new angle, looking at the science behind the science fiction. And with that, I'd like to welcome our speakers this evening. Dr. A. Bowden Bo Van Riper is a historian whose research focuses on the cultural dimensions of modern science and technology. He received his BA from Brown University and his MA and PhD from the University of Wisconsin-Madison. He is the author of, among other things, Science and Popular Culture, A Reference Guide, Rockets and Missiles, The Life Story of a Technology, and Teaching History with Science Fiction Films. A history professor for 21 years, he is currently research librarian at Martha's Vineyard Museum in Vineyard Haven, Massachusetts. Dr. Charles Chuck Adler is a physics professor at St. Mary's College of Maryland. He received his PhD at Brown University and has conducted research in a variety of areas of physics. He has written over 40 research papers and is the author of the popular book, Wizards, Aliens, and Starships, Physics and Math in Fantasy and Science Fiction, which was the co-winner of the 2015 American Institute of Physics Science Communication Award. He has also taught a course for the Great Course Lecture Series, How Science Shapes Science Fiction. He is a longtime fan of science fiction and fantasy, beginning with watching Star Trek reruns when he was seven, and he hopes one day to write his own work. Dr. Van Riper and Dr. Adler, it's over to you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Laura. And we felt it was a good idea to start tonight with the most iconic science fiction movie of modern times, Star Wars.
And it also gives us a very nice hook to start talking about things as well, the topic of Star Wars, or at least space warfare.
So I'm about to tell you something you're never going to be able to unhear, that famous final battle sequence in Star Wars. Dive, swoop, turn, zoom, explode, is really just every World War II flying movie you ever saw in space. Could we have clip number one, please, Laura?
Almost there.
Better let it loose.
They're right behind me.
Almost there.
I can't hold them.
Didn't go.
So what you're watching there is not Red Squadron and Gold Squadron attacking the poorly designed exhaust port on the Death Star. What you're watching is 11 Group defending London during the Battle of Britain. What you're watching as Gold Leader and his wingmen get shot to pieces is the massacre of the torpedo bombers at Midway. George Lucas, when he was storyboarding this, actually took the now obscure 1955 British film The Dam Busters, about a special operations raid on three dams in the Ruhr Valley, and used it as the basis for the missile runs down the trench on the Death Star. The problem with depicting space warfare this way is that what makes sense in the air over Europe during World War II, diving and swooping and all that stuff, makes no sense at all in space, because no air, no need to swoop, and no bank turns. But my gosh, is it dramatic and exciting.
Yeah, the actual warfare in space is going to be quite different than what you actually see in these movies. If you are like me, a child of the 80s, you will remember the Strategic Defense Initiative, a program started by President Reagan, which was derisively called Star Wars from the series of movies. It was an attempt to create a missile defense system in space, but the term Star Wars was used very derisively because there were a lot of inherent flaws in the system, which basically the idea was to orbit, essentially pop up X-ray lasers and particle beams around the Earth in order to be able to shoot down ballistic missiles, presumably fired at us by the Soviet Union. But again, there were a lot of problems with it.
One of which was pointed out by Arthur C. Clarke, a science fiction writer who earlier in his career was also famous for developing the theory behind communication satellites as relays. And Clarke pointed out that the thing with having a really expensive, also really fragile, hunter killer satellite in orbit is that all you have to do is launch, say, a bucket load of nuts, bolts, and random scrap metal into the same orbit going the opposite direction. And as the bits of scrap metal spread out and encounter the satellite has a very, very bad day, like a watermelon getting hit by a shotgun blast.
Yeah, and this actually kind of underlies the modern doctrine for space warfare. It's shown in all the movies as basically defenseless planets being attacked by, you know, all of these fleets from space and raining destruction from above. The reality is actually quite the opposite. Modern space war doctrine essentially is all about anti-satellite warfare. The issue here is that satellites are essentially the most important assets that countries have in space. They provide information. You know, information basically is used in all aspects of modern warfare. Communication satellites, GPS, spy satellites, things like that, but they can be taken out much more easily from the ground than you can actually launch an attack from orbit down to the ground. This was actually shown in 2019 when India actually fired a killer set, you know, basically fired a rocket system to actually take out one of their own satellites. This is actually a move that was widely condemned by other countries, because this actually created a fair amount of space debris spreading around, this bucket of nails that Bo was talking about, which could actually interfere with other satellites. Interestingly enough, this is a little bit off topic, but this idea, the idea that a collision of two satellites or a collision of a satellite with something else spreading a lot of debris, which could then take out other satellites, was the basis behind the movie Gravity, the one with George Clooney and Sandra Bullock, is in fact a real theory called the Kessler syndrome, in which a collision like this leads to creation of space debris, leading to more satellites being taken out, leading to an exponential growth, and ultimately a catastrophic number of satellites failing because of all the debris left in orbit. The movie was inaccurate because of the timescales involved, but it is in fact a real theory about what could actually happen if we actually have enough junk accumulating in orbit.
So this discussion about things accumulating in orbit brings up another interesting topic, which is how space travel actually works. And here, the gold standard for science fiction films, ever since it came out more than 50 years ago, has been Stanley Kubrick's 2001, A Space Odyssey. 2001 gets an amazing amount of stuff right. The famous double circle space station rotates in order to produce gravity, as does the part of the crew module and the Discovery that's taking our very, very, very taciturn heroes to Jupiter. Kubrick's depiction of how bodies behave in free fall is extremely accurate. He even in this cockpit of his space freighter depicted a modern style cockpit where all the data comes up on changeable computer screens. But all this accuracy comes at a price, which is that space travel is actually incredibly boring to watch because you have to move really, really carefully and slowly. It's bringing two spacecraft together in orbit is an incredibly precise, deliberate dance. Now, to Kubrick's credit, in the famous Pan Am docking sequence early in the film, he actually plays up the whole dance idea and makes it a significant part of the story, which we want to demonstrate by showing you two brief clips from that sequence spliced together, sorry folks, with an incredibly kludgy edit involving the number one, just to show the lapse of time. So could we have the second clip, please? So Kubrick in those two clips does two things. First, he shows us in that wonderful bit with this shuttle swooping in from the lower left, that the space station is simultaneously in orbit around the Earth, but also rotating around its axis. And in that opening clip, we've got the shuttle essentially chasing the station, trying to catch up with it so it can line up for a docking in that rectangular slot in the center hub. In the second clip, he shows the shuttle having caught up with the station and now having matched its orbit around the Earth, the shuttle, Kubrick demonstrates, has to match the station's rotation so that it can slide into the docking bay. Kubrick shows us the shot over the pilot's shoulders in which the shuttle's lined up and you don't see the docking bay twisting around relative to the shuttle. And then he pulls back to show us why this is. The station's rotating and the shuttle too is rotating around its own long axis at exactly the same rate. The astonishing thing, the thing that makes Kubrick, is that he doesn't tell you any of this. There isn't a lot of chatter between the pilots or between the pilots and the approach controller on the space station. It's entirely silent, except for the Blue Danube, which plays up the idea that this is a complicated dance between two multi-ton objects thousands of miles above the Earth. But if you've ever sat and watched this in a theater, it makes it clear that this is a very slow, deliberately paced thing. This is not the missile runs on the Death Star. It's accurate, and the price of accuracy is being, in the eyes of many filmgoers, a bit on the dull side. An exciting day in space is generally not a good thing. Kubrick, I should say, because I'm a historian and historians do these things, is not just pulling this science and this technology out of thin air. What he put on the screen all the way through 2001, whenever there are people in space, was a vision of what future space travel would look like that had been sketched out beginning in the very late 40s by an illustrator named Chesley Bonestell and an ex-German rocket scientist named Willy Ley in a book called The Conquest of Space. The Conquest of Space was the visual blueprint and the conceptual blueprint for virtually every science fiction movie about space travel in the 50s and the early 60s that was trying to be scientifically accurate. And indeed, had NASA been given unlimited budget and zero political constraints, the follow-on to the Apollo project that it might have built someday in the late 20th century might have looked very much like what Stanley Kubrick put on the screen. Everybody, in effect, was cribbing from the same playbook when they tried to make scientifically accurate space travel movies in the 50s and 60s.
And I'll just make a comment about that. As Herb Levy pointed out also in the chat, that Arthur Clarke actually did serve as a scientific consultant and co-writer on the movie. So yeah, his ideas were actually very much intermixed in the movie. But he was also a contemporary, and I believe a friend of Willy Ley and possibly Bonestell as well. Is that right, Bo?
I think so. I mean, he and Ley would have moved in the same rocketry circles in the late 40s for sure. And I don't know if he knew Bonestell or not, since Bonestell was working out of New York, not Europe.
Right. But, whether or not you make it exciting like Star Wars or, very deliberate as in 2001, there is one question you have to ask about these depictions of humans in space, which is, why are there humans in space? Now, science fiction, probably from the time of Jules Verne up until, up until perhaps the 1980s, was probably thought of as the literature of space travel. And in fact, in movies and perhaps on TV, it probably still in many ways is still thought of that. Or at least is a very large amount of science fiction in movies and TVs is taken up with space travel. And in there, you actually see people out in space. But this is, again, kind of the reverse of our actual space program, where, in fact, most missions are robotic, unpersoned missions. Now, this is a reversal of expectations from the 1950s onwards. Robert Heinlein, the great science fiction writer, once very famously wrote that the human colonization of space is inevitable. And I have books from the 1970s which talk about populations of millions or even billions of people living off planet in that far off year of 2020 or 2021. And it just didn't happen. So what happened actually to change that around? Well, back in the 1950s, or even possibly the 1970s, people viewed the human role in space as basically being central. The reason that it is not central today was the amazing and incredible advance in computer technology from the 1950s onwards. Back in the 1950s or 60s, you could not imagine putting a computer onto a spacecraft. Computers were these huge things filled with vacuum tubes that flashed on and off, which took up rooms and weighed tons. You weren't going to be able to put something like that onto a spacecraft. And basically, I don't think really many science fiction writers envisioned the computer revolution where they got so amazingly fast and so amazingly small and so amazingly cheap as they did today. But they did. And this, in fact, in turn, revolutionized the space industry in two separate ways. First of all, It basically made the robotic probes possible. You know, things like the unpersoned probes possible. Things like the Voyager spacecrafts or the more recent rover missions on Mars, where you could actually basically have them semi-autonomous or controlled from, controlled by computers. Secondly, you also had the ability to basically plot trajectories with very, very high accuracy at very little cost. And the idea here is that, when people looked at space travel back in the 1950s or 60s, science fiction writers tended to use as the simplest possible trajectories to get from here to there. What they did not envision was the mathematics of the gravity assist trajectory, which was invented back, I think, in the 1960s, where in fact you could actually speed up a spacecraft or change its direction or slow it down by making close approaches with various planets. This is again very famously used in the Voyager spacecraft, but I want to show you one more recent for the Dragonfly mission to Titan. Could you please put up the image for that? So what we see here is a preliminary idea for the proposed mission out to Titan with the Dragonfly probe. What you can see there is essentially what's going on, that is you actually have essentially three different gravity assists from Earth. Basically goes on, goes around a trajectory, makes three gravity assist boosts from Earth, one from Venus before it moves on. And this trajectory, the preliminary proposal for this trajectory takes up 20 pages of very, very highly technical work. But with the with computers being so cheap, one could actually compute these sorts of trajectories to extremely high accuracy. But at the expense of time. What these trajectories do is trade off essentially time for energy. You get a long trajectory, which is again suitable for a unpersoned probe, taking something like 10 years to get there. But you can't basically put people on there because it essentially takes way too long. The other thing, of course, as well about that, in terms of why unpersoned probes are better, is of course, first of all, they're a lot cheaper. You don't have to provide air or food or have them survive when they get out there, bring them back, which more than doubles the cost. And also, of course, if you lose a probe, it's a loss of a machine, not a loss of people.
So this brings us into robots and science fiction. And as Chuck said, one of the advantages of robotic space probes is that they're tools, no humans involved. You can throw them away at the end of the mission. If something goes horribly wrong and they have an exciting day in space, all you've lost is a tool. But this is where culturally the increasing sophistication of our machines, and specifically the increasing sophistication of computers that allow these robots to function semi-autonomously and to even seem to think for themselves, starts to loop around and bite us. The more sophisticated and the more capable our tools become, our robots become, the more we tend to endow them in our minds with human characteristics, the closer they seem to us. Not only in their capabilities, but also in some cases in their appearance. Can we have the rover and thank you. So here's XKCD imagining what's running through the thought processes of one of the Mars rovers as it reaches the end of its service life and NASA prepares to abandon it. And honestly, if you can read this without getting a lump in your throat, I'm not going to invite you to my next birthday party, because it gets at something deep and fundamental about the way we have come to think about some of our machines. Now, part of it, admittedly, too, is those darn binocular lenses mounted on top of the neck-like stalk. And could we have the other rover graphic, please? A convention in robot design that doesn't just show up in NASA Mars rovers, but that it shows up in films like WALL-E and back to 1984 in Robot Number 5 from Short Circuit. Again, those two separated lenses mounted on a head-like thing on top of a neck-like stalk triggers something deeply wired into our lizard brain that makes us look at large-eyed, large-headed things and say, oh, how cute, how adorable, and want to take care of them, which can be a problem if the thing you're building them for is to be abandoned on another planet millions of miles away. If you look back at the history of science fiction stories about robots, all the way back to Carol Capek's Rossum's Universal Robots in the 1920s, where the term was said to have been coined, you get people grappling with this, what's the difference between our robots and us if our robots get really, really good at doing the things we want them to do? And it's why recent stories about robots, the Battlestar Galactica reboot, for example, or the Westworld TV series, tend to be about robots that are so similar to humans and so sophisticated in their ability not just to mimic human thought processes, but mimic human emotions and behavior, that they make us think about what it actually means to be human. If robots are so sophisticated that a robot seems indistinguishable from us, then are we justified in treating them as a disposable tool, or do they at some point cross a threshold in which they are deserving of human standing in society? There are, of course, stories about robots that don't necessarily go to those philosophical depths. There are stories like Short Circuit, for example, that are simply retreads of Pinocchio in a technological form, with the robot, like the wooden boy in Pinocchio, trying to cross the magic gulf that separates it from a human. Robin Williams and Bicentennial Man, for example, or R2-D2, who, as we all know, despite not being humanoid, is the wittiest character in the entire original Star Wars trilogy. The flip side of this is, if robots can be as good or better than we are, what if they realize that and decide that we're not really necessary? The epitome of this in recent filmmaking is, of course, the Terminator series, in which our machines get talking to each other and decide that, you know, we really don't need those pesky bags of flesh and blood anyway. Let's just stage a small global thermonuclear war and be done with it. In that respect, the Terminator and the original Terminator movie taps into the same fear as the shark in Jaws. It's a relentless, single-purpose killing machine that can't be reasoned with, can't be talked out of it, can't be distracted, that will keep coming and coming and coming no matter how many yellow barrels, that will keep coming and coming and coming after you until you're dead. A really, really great tool. You know, 100% efficiency, can't beat that. A really, really alarming sentient being to have to share the planet with. In Battlestar Galactica, the reboot now, not the one with the purple chrome robots from the 70s, This idea, these two ideas get fused. You've got a technological race of beings that wages a genocidal war against flesh and blood humans, and yet, at the same time, that are themselves so human that they, it's entirely legitimate for characters in the story to wonder if, in fact, they have not just moral standing, but souls and the capacity for spirituality and all the other things that we associate only with flesh and blood humans, and that back to the days of early evolutionary human evolutionary theory in the 19th century, we've clung to as a species as the one thing that definitively sets us apart from machines, from animals, from every other complex being that seems to act and move and think like us on the surface. We're different because we're spiritual, we tell ourselves. Well, okay, says Battlestar Galactica. What if your robots were spiritual? How now, human race? Now, if robots are about what it means to be human, aliens are in science fiction something altogether else. Aliens are about how we as humans deal with others. Star Trek famously set out in the 60s and subsequently in the 80s and 90s to make a point about the essential brotherhood of all sentient life. And most of the aliens in Star Trek famously were bipedal humanoid. They were called rubber forehead aliens because the only difference between you and your average Bajoran was that they had this wrinkly rubber thing on their forehead. Thank you, makeup department. Star Trek even famously made interspecies couples routine. I co-wrote an article once on miscegenation in science fiction, and the number of interspecies couples in Star Trek is just staggering. And yet...
if you look at it, Carl Sagan once wrote that a human being would have a better chance of mating with a petunia than with a Vulcan. Then of course, you know, basically because humans and petunias are actually much closer in terms of it, in terms of their species than a human and a Vulcan would, who might not even have DNA, for example. The one thing again about the discovery of alien life, is that when we discover it, it's probably going to be as varied as human life, as life on Earth is. And it's much, we are, you know, again, the phrase, you know, rubber forehead alien, to distinguish against that, another phrase is starfish alien, aliens that basically, intelligent creatures that look basically nothing like humans. And, you know, the question, of course, is that those types of aliens, I suspect, are far more likely to occur. We're far more likely to interact with them, if we ever actually do are able to interact with them, than humanoid ones. So the question is, of course, how in the world do we in fact interact with intelligent squid-like creatures, or you know, with ones that basically behave in the same, in a similar way to bees or birds? You know, how do we actually get over our innate prejudices about what our intelligence, what intelligence means, or what culture means, or communication or civilization?
Which is why, for my money and for a lot of people's money, one of the original Star Trek's finest moments in delivering its all sentient beings, regardless of their appearance, are genuinely brothers and sisters to one another, came in the first season episode, The Devil in the Dark, in which the alien in question was the Horta, which looked sort of like a sentient lava flow. Could we have the Horta clip, please?
All right, let's go.
Come on.
How you doing, Doc?
I'll let you know.
All right,
no, don't fire!
Kill it!
First man that fires is dead.
That thing has killed 50 of my men.
And you've killed thousands of her children.
What?
Those round silicon nodules that you've been collecting and destroying, they're her eggs.
The thing I love about that moment is that the Horda is the most alien of aliens in the original Star Trek series, and yet Kirk standing between an angry mob of miners on the one hand, all of whom are fully human despite their questionable taste in jumpsuits, is standing between them and this utterly alien creature that seems incomprehensibly ugly and dangerous, instantly and without hesitation threatens to shoot the humans to save the monster. Because he, thanks to Spock's mind meld with the Horda, has recognized and instantly accepted, being the cool 24th century guy that he is, the fundamental sameness of their thought processes. The Horda at the end of the day is just a mother trying to protect her young. And that's something Star Trek would argue that any sentient being can understand and relate to. The Horda wasn't Star Trek's last really alien. There were the Organians, who were beings of pure energy, who only looked like they were simple farmers, who were about to get caught in a galactic war between the Klingons and the Federations, which it turns out they were capable of stopping with a snap of their fingers. There was the Borg, who embody the idea of a collective hive mind in which there is no individuality. And the prophets who live in the wormhole of Deep Space Nine, who experience time in a non-linear fashion, which in both the pilot and the series finale makes it awesomely difficult for Ben Sisko, the protagonist, to communicate with them.
Now, the issue, of course, with Star Trek was that Star Trek essentially foresaw essentially community and communication, apart from the Borg, with alien species. And again, a participation in the Federation of Alien Races. For an opposite view of this, I'm going to refer people to Ender's Game, where Earth is in an existential war with an alien species called the Formix, the human's name for them, who are essentially kind of an ant-like collective, which really have no true individual minds, but are kind of ruled over by essentially something like the queen of an ant colony. And again, the humans do not understand the Formix don't understand the humans, and are so therefore in this very long drawn out war. Now, the Formix are again kind of represented as sort of collective insect behavior, which, as I understand it, is a bit of a misrepresentation of how actual ant colonies work. But again, this goes back sort of to the deep-seated sort of human fear of the other, as the Formix are essentially demonized by humanity, and Ender and other children like him are pressed into, essentially drafted into warfare because their minds are more flexible. What we have here is kind of an interesting theme in science fiction. First of all, I should mention that Ender's Game is strikingly similar to an earlier science fiction novel called The Forever War by Joe Haldeman, which was published in the mid-1970s, which was actually to a certain extent a reflection of Haldeman's views on the Vietnam War, which he had actually been in. But you actually have very similar, Ender's Game by Orson Scott. I'm talking about Ender's Game by Orson Scott Card. But yeah, Joe Haldeman in The Forever War was actually more reflecting on his experiences in Vietnam. But again, there you have the same sort of conflict with this aliens who form a collective intelligence. And you actually see this theme of individuality versus collectivism a lot in American science fiction from kind of the 1950s onwards. I suspect as sort of the issues involving Cold War tensions and things like that. But one of the things about that, of course, is that in Ender's Game, probably very deliberately, Orson Scott Card has actually the Earth's government becoming much more repressive and collective in its viewpoint during the war against the Formix. Of course, at the very end, I won't spoil the end of it for you either for the movie or the book. But again, a lot of it is based on kind of a misunderstanding between the Formix and the humans.
And so we come back to where we began, warfare in space. And certainly, if you look back over the history of science fiction, back to H.G. Wells and the Martians landing in London, or in the radio version, New York, there's a great deal in science fiction of fear that when we meet the aliens, they'll come with guns drawn and conquest on our on their minds, or that they'll want to turn us into food supplies or whatever. But it's worth noting that side by side with that in science fiction, there exists this parallel hope that when we come to meet the aliens for the first time, they'll come in peace with their hands outstretched, the Vulcans in the Montana clearing in Star Trek First Contact, the formless aliens of 2001 reaching out to Dave Bowman in that weird French Rococo bedroom, or Michael Rennie and his robot companion Gort striding down the steps of their flying saucer onto the Washington Mall saying, "Get your act together, humans, and don't leave the planet until you've learned to play nice with each other and other sentient species, because you don't want to make us come down there again." Those two visions of humans and aliens have coexisted in science fiction for virtually as long as there's been science fiction. And the question remains, that which H.G. Wells had his main character pose at the end of what became the film Things to Come in 1936. Which one will it be? The universe or nothing at all? Which one will it be, Passworthy? Which one will it be? Thank you all for listening, and we'd like to throw it to Trillian to handle any questions you might have.
Thank you.
Thank you both so much. That was absolutely fascinating. So, if anyone in the audience this evening has questions that they would like to ask, those of you in Zoom, if you can please use that Q&A function at the bottom of your screen to submit your questions, we'll do our very best to get to as many as we possibly can. Those of you who are joining us this evening on Facebook, please feel free to pop your questions in the comment section, and we'll still be able to get those over to Chuck and Bo. So it looks like we have a few to get us started. So first of all, Michael's question. In the scene from 2001, the astronauts on the spaceship are spinning at the same rate as the station, but they're not as far from the axis as the people on the station. Won't they experience some sort of vertigo?
They absolutely will. This is actually, I think, one of the more unrealistic parts of 2001. A friend of mine and I actually once basically looked into this mathematically, and you get some very weird effects if you have a very small space station rotating around for gravity. You get very, you know, when you throw something, you get a traveling on a very extremely bizarre trajectory, you're going to suffer vertigo because your head is not moving at the same rate your feet are moving. You're going to feel a much lighter gravity up at your head, maybe by about a third as much as at your feet, depending on how wide the ship is. So yes, the answer is absolutely yes. You can get a very big station if you actually want to have artificial gravity like that from rotating the station.
Thank you. Okay, up next. So Star Trek had a transporter. Is it likely that we will ever be able to sort of beam up and beam down using that theoretical tech that we see on screen there?
Can I take that, or is that?
Go for it. Yeah, okay. I'll throw in something at the tail, but you go.
I very much doubt it. The problem is that the amount of information you would need to actually track all of your body's atoms and molecules is just so humongous that I don't think that you could actually tear something apart and then beam it somewhere else and then reassemble it at the other end. The other issue, of course, is that by almost any definition, that's murder. You know, there is no way I would ever go through a teleportation booth, no matter how perfect the copy of me was at the other end. because I think that you would just simply cease to exist during the first phase of it. And what would come back out again would be a very clever copy.
And, you know, it's interesting because in, I think by the time of Next Generation, they actually start throwing the phrase Heisenberg compensator around, which is, feels very much like the writers going, yes, yes, we know this wouldn't actually work because you couldn't specify the position and velocity and everything else of every particle in a person simultaneously, let alone not beam them into the middle of the living room sofa. You thought the fly was bad, you know. Anyway, but you know what? We're going to pretend that it actually works, just like we use the phrase warp drive to hand wave the whole, it's, you can't accelerate past light speed per Einstein, or at least last we looked. I will just say I'm with Chuck and Dr. McCoy. I am deeply distrustful of the whole transporter thing. Give me a shuttlecraft any day.
Yeah, there is, mentioning the Heisenberg compensator, there's a maybe apocryphal story that you've probably heard, Bo, about someone asking one of the showrunners how the Heisenberg compensator worked. And the answer was, very well, thank you.
Yeah. Which is, of course, the perfect answer.
Okay.
Medium indeed. Someone commented.
Yeah, sorry, I'm trying to make sure I keep up with all the comments here at the same time. Okay, let's do this one next, as I'm realizing we might not get through all of these questions. So Mark's asked about something that is almost never mentioned, the economics of space wars. Surely a Death Star or a Star Destroyer would cost trillions of dollars at a minimum. Can you speak to that for us?
I'm gonna go with the obvious comment, which is absolutely. And I would add on top of that, Diana Wynne Jones famously observed in her Tough Guide to Fantasy Land, which is a satire on the conventions of genre fantasy, that fantasy writers are absolutely, and J.K. Rowling definitely included, are absolutely famous for creating two kinds of systems that categorically don't work. One is ecologies, and the other one is economics. And so too galactic empires. The problem with scaling up, say, the 17th century Dutch Empire or the 19th century British Empire to galactic scale is exactly the one you propose, that the amount of wealth it would take to construct even one Star Destroyer would bankrupt your galactic empire before it even got around to saying, oh, we don't really need Alderaan, do we?
I think that one of the things that's very few science fiction writers ever consider, this goes to Bo's comment about economics, is the issue of infrastructure. If you look at what it actually takes to launch a spacecraft, there is so much more than just the spacecraft itself. You've got radar tracking stations all over the world. You've got the hard work of engineers and physicists who put the model together. You've got all the training that the astronauts go through in order to go on the mission. And again, it amounts to enormously more than just things like the fuel costs or the cost of actually putting all the parts together.
Fantastic, thank you. Okay. Next, let's go with Gary's question. As artificial intelligence and robotics take a greater role in our lives, how will that change our perceptions of science reality? For example, robots don't have to look humanoid, or don't even need to take on a tangible form, or thinking about Spock, reasons beyond our sort of human logic. Who'd like to get us started on that? Bo?
I'll toss that to Bo.
That's a really interesting question. And I think we've already crossed the threshold where we've decided that we can live with machines of extraordinary capabilities that we still treat as tools in the same sense as the screwdriver in your junk drawer or the jack in your car trunk as a tool. I really think it comes down to not capability or not even similarity of ability to humans. Machines that can think aren't going to stress they may stress our concerns about job prospects in the future. Will your next boss be an artificial intelligence? Is your current boss an art? No, anyway. I think the thing it's going to come down to is human affect. In other words, the incredibly sophisticated machine that doesn't look like us or that doesn't have a physical form is not going to trouble our sense of moral boundaries. The far less sophisticated machine that is bipedal and ambulatory and has a human face is going to trouble our sense of where the boundaries of humanity are a lot, in part because it's going to trigger all our cultural memories about enslavement, our cultural memories about the oppression of the poor by the wealthy, yes, we want to take over that country over there. You folks go march into the masked musket and cannon fire, please. Thank you. That's a good lad. In a way that non-humanoid technologies don't. And this goes to the fact that humans are wired to recognize patterns, not to analyze underlying structures, which causes us as a culture to make some really, really weird decisions about technology. But that's a whole nother lecture.
There's an interesting example of that in some of Isaac Asimov's stories, in which I think one of the, I don't remember whether it was one of the later Foundation novels, where there are two robots that are presented, one of which is humanoid, one of which does not have a very human appearance. And everyone essentially naturally assumes that the humanoid one is the far more superior and intelligent one. And it turns out exactly the opposite. The one that does not look human at all is actually far more intelligent and capable than the humanoid one. And in fact, kind of uses its appearance to kind of disguise its real nature.
Then I wonder if I can ask as the follow on to this. So thinking less about, I don't know if you guys have spotted this question from Rebecca, who mentions the robots in Interstellar are programmed with personalities for the human astronauts' benefit, but are still designed to be disposable tools. So thinking less about appearance and more about personality, she's asking then, is that a direction that modern robotics are actually going in? Or is that even more problematic for us as humans to deal with if the personality is there, even if the appearance isn't?
I suspect that is the direction we're going in, because if you look at it, for example, another example is the movie Her, in which the robot didn't even actually have a physical body. You know, it was essentially embedded in, you know, software, or was just existed essentially as a voice, or maybe, you know, a virtual simulation. There was this interesting thing that happened a few years ago at Georgia Tech, where a professor of artificial intelligence actually coded in an AI homework TA, I think, if you heard about this, which would essentially answer students' questions. And he gave it a female name. And students, when interacting with it via, you know, through the web or through texts or whatever, just essentially assumed that it was a person they were interacting with. And this is something that passed the Turing test. Okay, this is the Turing test, basically, writ large. And I think it was something like 80% or something of the students actually assumed that this AI was a real person they were interacting with. So I think, yes, I think that is, in fact, definitely the way that robotics are going in. I don't think AIs will, in fact, even have a corporeal form in some sense in the future.
Alexa's take on this?
Sorry, what was that?
Could we pause and get Siri and Alexa's take on this? And just one trailing thought on that. If I don't know what's going on in the leading edge of robotics particularly, but from an economic point of view, it would astound me if they weren't working on that in that direction, because at the moment, customer service is one of the last bastions of machines can't do it, only humans can. And cracking the challenge of machines that can counterfeit human interactions fluidly seems to me to be right up there with cracking the problem of genuine text to speech, or rather speech to text translation that can deal with homophones and that doesn't make you say the word comma when you want a comma.
You're really confusing our Zoom auto captioning right now.
Sorry about that, those of you following along in the captions. And the challenge, of course, in creating a physical shell to go with the Turing test passing personality is that it turns out to be incredibly complicated to create a truly human-like artificial form. And you may have, those listening may have heard of the phrase uncanny valley, which is where you wind up when you create something that's almost human looking, but just unhuman enough that it's really, really creepy. It's the thing dolls that unnerve you do so because they fall into the uncanny valley. They're recognizably supposed to be human, but there's something a little bit off. Mm-hmm. And creating a human-like robot that is supposed to mimic us, but rather than looking like the Cylons in Battlestar Galactica, looks like a creepy doll from a B movie that comes to life and murders you in your sleep, probably not a good business decision.
Thank you.
And note.
Okay, let's do one last question really quickly, maybe. Can you talk about a little on the medical innovations that can be seen in Star Trek, the hypersprays, diagnostic beds and such? Is that something you've written on? And can you talk about perhaps some of the, I guess, the possibility there? Possibly.
Yeah. Chuck? That's way outside my wheelhouse. I try to avoid actually talking about medical stuff because I know very, very little about it. So sorry.
I observe that to understand just how well, especially original series Trek nailed that, you have to cast your minds back to what medical care was like in the 60s before laparoscopic surgery, before microsurgery, before fiber optic cameras that they could thread into improbable parts of your body and look at you from the inside without doing major surgery to open a window. There's that line in The City on the Edge of Forever when Dr. McCoy winds up in the 1930s and just the knowledge of what surgery was like in the 20th century sends him into absolutely paralytic horror. He rants about people cutting and sewing patients like garments. And I think Roddenberry and company, in the broadest sense, nailed that in that their diagnostic beds and Dr. McCoy's wave it over the patient and it seals up the wound or whatever. Even if they didn't get the details right, they got the fundamental concept that in the future, surgery and medical care, for major injuries, will be, by the standards of the 20th century, incredibly non-invasive and will not do secondary damage to the patient's body that will then have to be healed independently of whatever you were cutting them open in order to fix in the first place. So like Chuck, I'm not conversant enough with the details of where medicine is going to know whether we're headed towards hypo sprays and waving a light up salt shaker over the patient to get their vitals. But I think in the big picture, start this and the flip open communicator is probably Star Trek's greatest case of, you guys sure you don't have a crystal ball?
Yeah. Well, I will. Yeah, I think you're right about that, Bo. I will add on one place where I think Star Trek failed at the medical stuff, which is my least favorite episode of Next Generation, called Rascals, where a transporter malfunction de-ages Picard and a bunch of the other crew down to 11-year-old children or 7-year-old children or something like that. And my own pet peeve about that was, that is an amazing piece of medical technology. You've just conquered aging. People can be immortal, you know? And it was never mentioned again.
Absolutely.
Fantastic. The magic of television, I guess, yes. Right?
In a very literal sense.
Yes.
Yes. Yes. Well, so I think I'm afraid with that, I have to wrap us up for this evening. I just want to take a minute to say thank you so, so much, Chuck and Bo, for just such a fantastic conversation and for guiding us through this complicated subject. So thank you so much for joining us.
Well, thanks. Thank you for having us.
Just a couple of extra little notes. So we're going to drop some links in the chat right now. We have, as Laura mentioned now, just two programs left connected with our exhibit, Jews in Space, Members of the Tribe in Orbit. First up is next Wednesday. You can register for our last virtual tour of the exhibit with our visitor services expert, Talia Makowski. We also have next Thursday night, we're welcoming Dr. Ryan Dowdy of the Johnson Space Center in Houston, who is in charge of the food system manager for the International Space Station. Should be an absolutely fascinating conversation. As we mentioned right up at the beginning, it is now possible to register to come and see the exhibit before it closes in mid-June. So we will also drop the link in chat for more information on the COVID safety precautions we're taking and how to register for a chance to visit on site. And then I also just want to highlight for everyone for 1 second, if you go back a tiny bit in chat, one of the members of the audience shared a link to Balticon. That is the Baltimore Science Fiction Society's annual convention that is taking place in May. The team over at Balticon have been a huge, huge support to us in spreading the word about this exhibit and our programming. And so I do just want to take a moment to give them a quick shout out and recommend for those of you just both locally and I'm guessing further afield, it's a great group to get involved with. We're also going to drop one last link into chat for you, which is a recording actually from our members opening way back in October. We spoke with Dr. Mark Okrand, the inventor of the Klingon language. It's a fascinating lecture, and I think one that if you enjoyed the presentation today, I think you'll also really enjoy that one. And so just with that, again, I'd like to say thank you for Laura for getting us open this evening, and thank you so much, Chuck and Bo. It's been wonderful hearing you this evening. So thank you, everyone, and we hope to see you again very soon. Thank you.
Good night, everybody.
Thank you so much.